our lunch. It is not that easy to listen to whatever teaching which we are doing. So I can understand, and also thank you for giving this opportunity. And also I think that we have not mentioned, I was also a full-time faculty in Model Law College here for 1 year before going to the Symbiosis Law School. So I also learned a lot from this university, from this campus, and I'm very happy that again I'm coming back to the same family, you know. So it is a very happy experience, like we are coming back. But this time always I used to take sessions on sociology, political science, legal research and all those courses. Now we are here with NEP 2020 implementation challenges, where it's a very relevant topic. I'm very happy that we are discussing a very relevant topic, because NEP 2020 for the entire country, because during the COVID time all of us are experienced this. You know how we can integrate technology in the education sectors, and there are, you know, all of you know that education sector is not one, there are many, private, public, you know, and you know, PPP model is also there. So every universities, every education institutions, integrating this is not an easy one, and equality is a bigger challenge when you are looking into it. So let us look into the, what is my plan here is like, what is the objective, like a legal analysis, we'll have to look into it, what is the objective? And what is achieved and what are the challenges. So we will look into that. First of all, we can see that, you know, national education policy, always education and technology. So both sides of the coin. Technology will lead to more education experiences, and education, with the good education, modern education, we can come with innovation in new technologies. The computer engineers, even the lawyers, can come with new technological, you know, startups and innovations and all in resolving the problem in teaching and learning. So these are both sides of the coin. One will be helping each other, because if education is there, then we can come with new technology. What type of technology we need to resolve the problem for convenience, you know, customer, student friendly technology or educational institution friendly technology. For example, now where is the classroom, where is your seat number, and what is the topics to study for the exam, and where I will get admission, what is my score, and too many things, too many questions are there for the, you know, those who are there in the campuses. So we need solution, even parking challenges is there. So we need answers for all these things. So technology can help in all these, all this. And always the goal in all education technology is enhancing or advancing the educational process and outcome, and to make sure that we can have a good planning management in education sector, in the campus, and in the state level, in the national level. So all of you know that in India we are having a Digital India campaign. So it was there before the education technology came. So where the campaign was also looking into it, Skill India, Digital India and all, through the forum of technology, how we can inculcate skills, how we can impart knowledge, how we can impart job opportunities, vocational training, that is the interest. So that is what going to change India. All of you know that even now we are talking, last week I was there in Yavat village, where this, I have gone to the schools, I have gone to the education institutions, no power, no teacher, you know, no electricity, even the, forget about the cell phones, they don't have electricity even. So how the students are going to learn? So these are the challenges which India as a country is facing. But we know that in India, maximum number of users of internet, maximum number of users of mobile technology, digital technology is also there, because that is also a good thing for India, and next 10 to 20 years that market is going to grow. So we are using the digital technology to have a more empowered society and to create knowledge economy. Knowledge is the power these days. Earlier we always felt like money is the power, muscle power, you know, but now the new modern era, what is the source and resource? Knowledge. Knowledge and skills. So that is the interest of how we can integrate technology in education sector. So that's why all of us faced online education. If I'm using online education, all of you know that distance education, even a lawyer from UK, even ICC, one of the experts can interact with all of you, and you are having a case and he can resolve your answers to that. And also when you are learning, you are having technology through which all the case management or all the cases related to one area, so you can compile it together with the help of different software. So that all of them are there. So in which the research learning is very, very easy for all of them. You don't want to search it. So that is there. But at the same time, the challenge, which is also an objective of the NEP 2020, is ensuring equitable use of technology. So all of you know that equitable use of technology, equality in India is a bigger challenge. India is not one. You know, urban India, rural India, literate India, illiterate India, men, women. So there are too much of diversity is there in India. So when you are looking into it, whether the technology is accessible to everyone in India, then that is a big challenge for which NEP is looking into it. The education institutions must come with that, you know, plan in which we must adopt those technology which is equally accessible to everyone. You know, those who are coming to the college or school or those who are outside. That was the objective for which there are, all of you us know that there are multiple challenges. So now let us look into the, you know, thrust of technological interventions as per the NEP. The first one is why we are using technology. What are the utility of using technology? And there are also new theories are coming that, you know, digital detoxication is also another challenge which all of you know that. We are having psychiatrist people are coming, you know, 1 hour that if the gadget is not there, they are becoming mad. Nomophobia, different type of diseases are also coming along with that. All of you know that too much of screen time is also not good. So here, major thrust of technological innovation or intervention was first one is teaching learning and evaluation process. Teaching. We don't want as lawyers always lecture method, you know. Whatever teaching good teacher you are, you know, imparting that to the students may not be there because every student is different. They are grasping power, understanding language, pace is different. So we need technologies, you know, instead of a lecture, that lecture or material will be there in the hands of the student. Based on their own mood, based on their time and space, they can study. And if any doubt is there, you can contact the, you know, the supervisor. So that type of a technology we need, which will be easy. The teachers also, now I am having this PPT, otherwise earlier all of you know that your teachers, the law classroom, big books will be there and the teacher, it will take half an hour for the teacher to search for that section, subsection. Now everything is there and students get referring to. So that is the second one is, so helping the teachers' professional development. So the teachers are also going through a tough time after the NEP now that you will have to use different software, different you know, links and things to you know, even right from admission, you know, students are applying to select who is the best student, to the evaluation, even later up to the convocation, the teachers will need training in knowing the technology. And there are many issues and all of you know that we don't have any answers like that, you know, in wherever I am working now. Symbiosis is a different story, at least the training is there, where in MIT, Valpuris University, they have shifted the portal from Code Tantra to HRMS to, you know, now the latest one is TCS IOM, a new one, in which students have learned very fast, but teachers were not able to learn, and the teachers are the proctor for exam. You know, during the exam, students will have to write and upload the answers. Even though it is a face-to-face, now even the students are coming to the campus, they are writing the exams online. So when they could not able to, they, in their network, it is telling that it is uploaded. But a teacher, those who are the proctor who is standing there, could not able to understand what is happening. And the exams were over. When the result came, more than 15-20 students failed, those who are very good students. So even now, it happened 2 weeks before. So what is that? There is no lack of training to the teachers. So teachers must be also be mentally prepared and readiness to unlearn and learn. That is also another important aspect. And enhancing the educational access. Here, access. You know, even somebody sitting in the rural area, in Kerala, maybe in Wayanad, who is a hilly area, that person can also, through this live streaming, so they can attend my lecture. Right? So the access is there, knowledge is there, even now, that's why you can say when you go to the rural area, even that when you are giving awareness, I'm a public health faculty, when you are going and informing them about the HIV or other things, they know better than, because they are used to all this media and they are getting information. So that is there. So giving accessibility, equality, affordability, here not only access, affordability, you know, whether, you know, when you are joining here and all, many times, in the modern global world, it is not the degrees that matters. Many people think that I am having a degree, LLM degree, but they don't know basics of any cases, articles, fundamental rights and all. So what is the use of that degree? Knowledge and skills matters. Even from this Pune, I am having lots of successful lawyers and judges in the court. Their scores may be very less, but they know they are in the court and they are practicing, and through experience practice they are, maybe different types of skills, which is the legal skills, or we can say the debating skills, and always client friendly, and make sure that they are a successful lawyer and who is getting 4 lakh, 5 lakh, whereas somebody who is having a topper score will not get. So here, skills can be also be imparted through the technology. So those who are poor students in the rural area can also, nowadays lots of mediation and all other skills are also required. So all the skills we can, imbibe with the help of the technology. And another one, just not all of you maybe, it is an area of interest to the principal and all, educational management and administration. Last 5 years, how many students applied, how many passing rate, and how many of them paid the fees, and how many male and female, all other data, because big data. With the help of a data, with the help of AR, different types of machine learning, tools, any data, anything, any decision making is very easy for the, education management, education planning, what all courses to start, there is a demand. All other things we will get it if you are, integrating the technology to the administration. Educational administration, even the education minister in Maharashtra with the tip of a finger knows that how many private colleges are there, how many private colleges, how many students are working, how many students are from Nanded, how many students are in Pune from Kerala. So you will get all the information if you are digitalizing it. So management, decision making, because otherwise we are starting colleges and all students are not there, and there is too much of demand for one area where the courses is not there. So all other things are easy with the help of a technology. And language barrier is also another thing. Maybe as lawyers, all of you are forced to learn English many times. All the literature, everything is in English. And even the English, because the case happened in a different context. Maybe the case happened in France. So then when you comparing the language, the exact, translation will not work. So here with the help of a technology, we can also remove the language barrier. We can understand what it means in your own language. Okay, so language barriers can also be taken care of. And the main other important interest of NEP was to take care of the disabled. We always use this word, divyangal. So, disabled students, they also must get new technologies. Those who are blind, those who are having different disability, physical disability, mental disability and all, we must come up new technology so that they can also learn and they can also work. So they will also get jobs. So this is also the interest of this NEP. So now all of you know that a new disruptive technology, era in which, AR, VR, AI, ML and all is there, augmented reality, virtual reality, now remote, surgeries are also happening. Now yesterday I interviewed one doctor where remotely with the help of a computer the surgery is happening, somebody else is doing the work here in the ICU, so the remote surgery is also happening. So in the same way, all of you lawyers, law, legal education technologies are something different, but in computer engineering, in biology, microbiology and many other disciplines, in a virtual reality, even though you don't have the lab, you can have an experience of the lab. So that is there, and virtual reality is a simulation type of a things are also encouraging. But in India, when you are looking into it, all the universities, colleges were not able to imbibe this technology. It is very costly and the technology is there, but it is not student friendly or the faculty friendly. And the faculties must also be ready to adopt those technologies. During the COVID time, different types of virtual labs and all started, but our students and the faculties are not, prepared to accept this. That is a learning. What is a learning? Because we are blindly embedded in the Western model, will not work. So we will have to have all these tools, digital disruptive technology, which is student friendly for different contexts, different culture. So faculty must also be mentally prepared. The second one is excessive research needed in new technologies. So all of you know that now many of the universities, even in Pune, when you are traveling, you can say that lots of programs like hackathon, pharmathon, you know, ideal thought type of a new competition is coming, in which the industries are also coming and giving their ideas, and they are also showcasing their startups, so that these type of technologies different education institutions can imbibe. And many of the edtech companies are doing lots of research, and they are integrating with the universities. Why they are integrating with the universities? Because universities knows that what they are looking for, what is their need, and the companies know the technology. So there is a academia industry interaction is happening, and we need lots of research on this area, in which even as lawyers, how we can use new technology for the legal education, you know, different type of, you know, legal tech things which we can use it, so that your learning will be very easy, your research will be very easy, analysis will be very easy, you know. So that is also happening. And third one is, before scaling up intervention, the use of integration of technology to improve aspects of education should be. So here, before deciding different types of an intervention, what is the meaning of the word intervention, any one of you? What is the meaning of the word intervention? We are using this technology to resolve one problem which is there. If the problem is not there, we don't want that technology, no? Technology must not create problem, it must resolve the problem. There is one problem, we need a better technology to resolve our problem. Okay, so that's why we'll have to make sure that whether that technologies are integrated to different aspects of education. So even when you are talking about education, education is not one, different disciplines are there, curriculum is different, teaching methodology is different, students are different in different contexts. So what is the best technology which we can use it for resolving the problem? So all of you, now it is your duty to look into it in a way, and what type of different technology you can use it in legal studies or legal research. Because all of you know that legal research methodology is evolving, you know, qualitative and quantitative, you know, what type of data you must collect, and whether the opinion matters, or judgment, last 10 years, what type of judgments is there, and what is the trend in those judgments, whether there is any one judgment which is different from, diverse from all other one. So all of them are possible with the help of, you know, when you integrate this technology. Now, I will just go to the, you know, National Education Technology Forum. NEFT is there. How many of you know about NEFT? This is the Prime Minister in his Twitter. This is, I have not taken from anywhere else. He himself is telling that this is our plan. NETFT is there, National Education Technology Forum, as per the NEPT which is there. And what is the duty of this forum? It, you know, they will have to actively help the central and state government to, you know, what type of technology intervention must be used in different education. So continuous research and advice must be given to the central government and the state government, because every state is not same in education. There are some states already integrated technology in education. And even in different states, in the public and private, you know, there is too much of diversity in technological integration. You know, private universities, because they are, even though they are for profit, but they know that if you are not using this technology, you will not get students. So for that, they are, you know, marketing it, whether how it is working, we don't know. But public universities also will have to cope up with that. Otherwise, it will affect their quality. So that is the main task. But at the same time, equality is a bigger thing. You know, there must be equality in technological transfer, which is the responsibility of the state. So they must come with policies. They must come with different forum within the state, so that everybody will be informing what type of technology they are using, and we need control also. We need some control also. Regulation also must be there. And intellectual and institutional capacities in education technology for it. What it means? I think that in the last 2 days, this discussion was already there. Capacity building. What do you mean by capacity building? Not only the teachers, the IT professional, the non-teaching staff, everybody must be knowing this, because right from your, you know, coming to the college and going out, in a day you will be using different technology, and data is created. There is too much of data is created every day in one form or other. So whether those who are giving the data is aware of it, what about the confidentiality, what about the privacy of that, and whether the capacity building training is done, but that staff is responsible for the student's future, or the teacher is responsible for the student's future. So whether the teacher is well equipped to, you know, take admission, for example, there may be lots of errors otherwise, which is happening. Many students are losing the admission, many students' result is not proper because of lack of capacity building. So errors, and we cannot blame the technology. We must blame the people, those who are using it. And what are the different trust areas in this domain? Whether we like, whether we can use it, you know, machine learning, whatever big data we can use it. Whether we must use it in different sectors like admission, evaluation, or record keeping, documentation. You know, which type of technologies must be used, even in disciplines. What are the disciplines in which we can use technology very easily? For example, philosophy and all, using technology is very tough. But even then, recordings, all things are possible. But there are computer engineering and mechanical engineering and all, we can use it a lot. Even legal law, legal technologies are also possible in case management. Not only in teaching learning, when you go out and start your own law firms, these technologies are going to help you in sudden decision making, sudden case delivery. Okay, so the technologies are there. And also now there is a trust, there is too much of projects are coming, sir, and DST projects are coming in which they are encouraging innovation in education technology. So if you want to write projects on that and all, you will be getting it. And an implementation committee has been set up state-wise, national-wise and all, in which they will discuss that these technologies are there and we have an MOU with this industry and we have started it. What are the positive things? What are the challenges? And they share the experience so that the implementation committee can take a decision forward whether to continue. Because many times technology changes happen in last 2 years. Every education institution, we started with something, maybe cost factor, maybe quality challenges, or third one, maybe privacy challenges. You are not able to protect the privacy. So there will be enough scope for all of you. You know, there are too much of cases coming on this. People are filing cases. So that too much of data protection is the new booming area. You know, privacy, you know, that is a new area in which too much of care must be taken care of before deciding. So adoption of emerging technology, this is the emerging disruptive technology, artificial intelligence, robotics, 3D, simulations, and lots of other things, other upcoming. We have to identify all those technology which is available for education, and National Education Technology Forum is there, and they will have to categorize it. This is for this different category. A category means which one we can use it, because all of you heard about the smart campuses. Smart campus technology is there when you go there, because you don't know, even in Pune University when you go there, you don't know where is this department, where is this research center, where is the guest house. We don't know. So with the help of a new technology, you press a button, all the direction will be given to you. And you also know that where the parking is there and all. And many of the people, those who are looking for applying in foreign university, it is already there. They are having a smart campus actually. So that must be there. So all other decision, domain area. So for what we can use technology, right from, understanding the campus, courses, and even the teaching learning pedagogy, evaluation, admission, and education management, we can use it. So where we must be using it. And then without research, we don't know, because we cannot blindly imitate the Western technologies. We need ground research through which what is this technology is all about, how it is useful for the different stakeholders of that university, and then accordingly we will have to decide. So continuous research and feedback must be required in the long run for the next 10 years when we are inviting these technologies, because many of the technologies are having many disadvantages, challenges also. So higher education institutions are having a very important role in dealing, making sure that they are integrating this technology in their decision making and all. So first one is research, second one is training. So I have seen many of the faculties, even in my department, many of them are attending this training, capacity building training, 5 days online and all. But when they are coming in, when we are telling them to give a presentation, they don't know. Because that type of effective technology is that if you don't know, the practical training is not happening. They are just attending, they are getting certificates, but they don't know how to do the work. Okay, so that challenge is there in India. That is a bigger challenge of our education system. Just learning may not work, practical oriented working and asking questions. I always used to tell my students, lawyers, you all of you know how to ask. Some of you, even main thing which skill which all of you must learn is how to ask the right questions. Asking questions is very, very important, because moot court and all, that is the one. But many of our law students don't know how to ask the right question. They will just ask some question. There are many instances in which when the guest comes, they give statement. They say that you are lawyers, why you are giving statement? We are looking for questions. The same thing, capacity building, why the faculty, those who are going there, that capacity, that skill is not inculcated to them because they are not mentally prepared. Somebody is forcing you, you are there. So inner, you must accept that now the digital era, and if you want to help each other, if you want to resolve problem, if you want to be a good teacher, you must learn these things, and you cannot afford to make mistakes. If the teachers are making mistakes, then what about the students? You know, so that is one here. When using these disruptive technologies, new technologies, capacity building of all teaching staff, non-teaching staff, including the management. If a registrar is the one who is monitoring that some complaint comes, he must know what technology must use and what is the data, from where the data is taken and whether the decision making is proper. So right from the registrar to the vice chancellor to everyone must be getting trained in new type of technology, because based on the technology, you know, decision making is only based on data. But if you don't know how to understand the data, assess the data, and if it is the wrong way it is inculcated in this technology, then the decision making will be the wrong one. And another one, now I think that is implementation is happening. Universities will have to offer all these PhDs and masters in different areas of machine learning. That's why all of you know that too much of mushrooming of programs like data, masters in data analytics, you know, department of artificial intelligence are coming in different universities. So that's why at least I think, but here just starting artificial department of artificial intelligence is not enough. What NEP is looking into it, these departments will have to find solution for our sustainable development goals. Our India 2030, we will have to achieve the sustainable development goals. I hope that all of you are knowing it, what is SDGs. SDGs. All of you are aware, I think. All of you are lawyers, you must know that. So here now it is 2023, only 2030, only 8 more years. And now you know that our health infrastructure, our education infrastructure, and agriculture challenges, agriculture technologies are spoiling our agricultural, you know, rural areas. You know, they are being told the farmers to use this technology. When the problem comes, there is no solution to them. And again, corrective measures are there at the cost of the land, fertility of the soil, and all. So here, in these professional areas, whether it is law, healthcare, agriculture, all these areas, you know, in these areas, the research must happen. Artificial intelligence must be used in this area. In healthcare, how we can use artificial intelligence? Now, all of you are having smartwatch. And during the COVID time, I do remember, because to get the blood sample, we have to touch and all. There are many things through which you can take the blood sample with the help of AR. We cannot even touch. So, many AI-based healthcare technologies are moving, even different types of T-shirts and shoes and all is there, through which, you know, you can monitor. So that is there. But in agriculture, the Department of Artificial Intelligence must know that in agriculture, how we can use technology to know that, you know, water, whether water level, quality of the soil, quality of the water. So for all these things, giving advices to the farmers, and also with the help of AI, where is the market for them, how much money they are going to get it. So all other things they must do, but whether that is happening, which we will have to monitor in the implementation. That is AI, everybody is starting. Every private universities are starting. Department of AI, and they are earning too much of money, like 2 lakh, 3 lakh rupees. And even the students are very happy that, yes, this is the market for us. But just learning AI is not enough. There are some core areas, so agriculture, health, education, these areas we'll have to look into it. Next one, when we are using artificial intelligence, is data protection, which all of you know that, you know, the privacy issues are there. In many of the nowadays, data is money, data is knowledge. And all of you assessed in this, law students definitely maybe have assessed the, you know, data protection bill, and that's, they have scrapped it, and again, too much of discussion is going on that. So we know that, you know, data protection, handling the data, and many times the university is having all the data related to the students or the faculties with them, how they are going to use it. Too much of crime, too much of violence, or they may be selling the data to the any companies, they will be using that. So we have to make sure that the data protection must be taken care of. So how, with the help of AI, data protection areas can be taken care of, that is also important. And another one, when you are looking into the data protection, we have seen that sustainability must be taken care of, because technology with a human face, technology must be helped in, you know, sustaining our environment. Because many times the technology is spoiling our environment. That must not be there. That I said that, you know, digital detoxification is a bigger challenge. How we can convert waste to wealth? That must be your question. With the help of technology, how we can convert waste to wealth? How we can convert, you know, even with the help of the technology, the slow learners can be converted into a good learner. So these type of questions we will have to look into it when we are looking into the AI. And this is using technology for online and digital education to address concerns of equity. So equity may be another challenge, because who is affording that? I said even now in Maharashtra there is a different implementation committees are there in, you know, Symbiosis, MIT and Pune University and all other universities are planning, and they will have to invest too much of money, you know, because cost is very high, and they will have to interact with the edtech companies to, you know, incorporate new technology for resolving their problem. But mostly these technologies are used for teaching learning, yes, online learning, and also used for evaluation, you know, but not used for many other purposes like smart campus and all other things. It is not yet used. Even preparing the reading materials, curriculum, you know, you can use new technology to create materials, curriculum materials. Why? Anyone of you, why that is a challenge? There is a precondition for that. Our curriculum is the outdated one. We will have to restructure our curriculum coping with the new technology. Because pedagogy, because our curriculum creators, they think that it is a lecture method, so they have prepared module 1, module 2, module 3, and this is the reference. And the teacher knows what teaching, they have to follow that. But you will have to keep in mind of the new technology. With the help of technology, then the curriculum revision is very, very important. Then accordingly, curriculum restructuring is very, very important. That's why even in teaching learning, what type of technology all of you are using? Online education is there, some video recording materials are there, but there are many other new interventions, new type of things we can use it, only provided the curriculum is revised, which is not happening. So curriculum revision is the very, very important task for all the universities if they want to prepare in integrating technology. So that is one. And another one, online and digital education, the challenges are there. Because as I said that, I want to use digital material, but material is not available. It is only in the book form. So how I can? So it will take time. So converting all your law book, which is 2000, 3000, and identifying the major points is very, very difficult. So creating the digital resources infrastructure itself is a task for all of you. Now during the COVID time, all of you bought many e-books. How many e-books are published now? So we have to look into it. So we need lots of infrastructure development in dealing with that. Then only this integrating technology in education will be possible. So one another thing which I feel like, you know, becoming, you know, mostly in our universities, screen-based education. We felt like, we are using smart boards. Smart boards is enough. What is smart? This is only, it was there in Western countries 20 years before. No, so this is not a use of technology in education, and many times the teachers are not ready even to, you know, use the PowerPoint, because in the PowerPoint whatever is, the students also knows it, you know, what is new they will have to add it. So, you know, using the digital technology means, you know, whatever lecture method is which is already given to the students, and in the classroom with the use of technology, different dialogue, discussions and debates can be happen in the class, so that knowledge generation will be happening in the class or outside the class. Sometimes students physically don't need to come here. The real work will be happening after the class. So they will have to, we will have to convert all our digital materials into a digital infrastructure. Only then, you know, integrating technology in education will happen. In our faculties or the teachers or educational, you know, stakeholders' mind, yes, in our university it's a digital, we are using digital technology. During the lab visit and all, we have seen it, you know. They will say that, yes, we are having smart board. But just having smart board is not the thing. What about your curriculum? What about your evaluation? What about your, do you know that in your students, how many students are, you know, having, scored this much? No, you don't have any answer for that. So because data is not collected also. data is also not there and not collected systematically. Some data is there, but we cannot use it. So that's why there are so much of limitations in certain type of courses, especially, I don't know how many university. I was there in Sipios Law College, and they were trying to convert, digitalizing their course materials. Every course, when the students come in one folder, all the material is there. They don't have to go to the, library. Everything is converted into a digital document, and paperless classrooms, and questions, every class, the questions and key learning is already prepared, and every syllabus itself, there is not topic and all, only links and books. There are too many links are there. So that type of a classroom which we need, and it needs lots of infrastructure, digital infrastructure. It needs lots of time to create that. But once you create it, the benefit is there to lots of people. That material, even synopsis, 2-3 courses they have done it as in a trial basis. But too much of demand, once it is coming online, there's too much of demand for that in all other colleges. Everybody wants that. They are ready to buy that materials. So too much of buyers will be there. So that's why digital education means just smart board is not there, and just screen-based education is not a digital education. You will have to have a digital-oriented materials, curriculum, evaluation, everything must be based on that. Because for example, in this class, who is the best participant in the class? If I want to know, how the teachers are going to enter? They don't remember in the class, you may be giving an answer. Another person may be giving some opinion. There is no way to enter into the system. But there are digital classrooms in which every student's name will be displayed in the board. Teacher will be one student, one mark, like that. In which by the end of the class, who is the best participant in the class? Who has given the correct answer? How many students ask supplementary questions? Everything must be clear. So that assessment will be very easy for the teacher. By the end of the day, it is not the last exam which is assessing. Every classroom, every discussion. All of you have heard of, how many of you know about Canvas, different things are there, LMS, Canvas and all. The Canvas platform, many people are working on it, in which there is a continuous dialogue happening between the teacher and the student. There is even the debates are happening. Sometimes I used to monitor. I am only a participant, coordinator. I am only a coordinator. I can see that any time, maybe the teacher may be an international faculty, somebody from UK. She is the one who is giving the digital documents, and she has first lecture, she has already given the lecture, and after the lecture she has asked questions, and the material is also there, you can refer it. And then after the lecture, the student is asking questions for which the teacher may not be having an answer. The teacher will have to read again to give the answer. Next day morning, teacher will have to give the answer. So there is transparency in teaching learning process, and everything transparent. There is no subjectivity. Everything is there. A third person can come and monitor. Academic auditing will be very, very easy. So those type of platform we need in India. So I'm just skipping this online digital education. Lots of challenges are there. There are way forward, optimizing and expanding existing digital platform and ICT-based initiative. What do you mean by optimizing? So some MIT use something, I am also using, will not work. You have to look into it. What is the background of the students? What type of discipline it is? What is the needs of the course? Accordingly, you will have to optimize the technology for your needs. Just somebody is using, for example, we thought that Code Tantra is the one which will be helping us. So we have used it. Later we understood that only evaluation is good, but for every lecture monitoring it is not good. So that every lecture, what is the topic is delivered, how many students were there, and what is the material. So even though you are not coming to the class, you will get every material. Even though you are absent, you will not fail in the exam. So you know that what is going on. But that is not happening. Then they have shifted to TCS Ion. But TCS Ion is good, but the students and teachers are not well informed. The training capacity building is not happened. So